Carbon dioxide is plant food, and animals can adapt to a changing climate because they've done it before, right? So what's the big deal? I hear this a lot from people, and it's true, animals have adapted to change before, but never at this speed, and never with their habitat so fragmented by human development that often there's no way for them to even get from where they live now to where they need to be as the world warms. The climate over the last 6,000 years or so has been remarkably stable. The only major change during that whole time is what we're seeing right now, the sudden warming due to humans burning fossil fuels since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. Then to see changes that happen at a speed and size anywhere near what we're experiencing today, we have to go back millions of years to what's called the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maxima, which happened about 55 million years ago. But even then, during one of the most extreme examples of natural climate change on record, it's estimated that the amount of carbon dioxide being pumped into the atmosphere from natural causes was only about a tenth of what humans are producing today. We are already in the middle of what scientists have termed the sixth extinction, the greatest loss of species the world has seen since dinosaurs died off about 65 million years ago. But whereas previous extinctions happened naturally, after catastrophic events like volcanic eruptions and asteroid strikes, the difference today is that we are causing this one. The culprit is so clear that another name for this massive die-off is the Anthropocene extinction. Now, global warming isn't the sole cause of this latest extinction. We're also contributing in other ways, like encroaching on animals' habitats, overfishing the oceans, introducing invasive species, and the acidification of the oceans as they absorb more and more of the carbon dioxide that we're putting into the atmosphere. But climate change is exacerbating those risks. And the faster it happens, the less time animals have to adapt. Between pollution, warming temperatures, and ocean acidification, over half of the world's coral reefs, the nurseries of the sea, have already been lost in the past 30 years. If these trends continue, 90% could be gone by 2050. All told, it's estimated that by the end of the century, between 30 to 50% of all species on Earth could be extinct if we continue on our current pathway. That includes a fifth of all mammal species, including the pika, a cute little creature like a chipmunk or an oversized hamster that communicates with a little eek sound and likes to live at high elevations in the Rocky Mountains. They like the cold, so as the climate warms, they don't have anywhere left to go. And today, only 16 out of 25 previously existing populations remain. Okay, so global warming isn't great for animals. But what about plants? Don't they use carbon dioxide in photosynthesis? Yes. So more carbon dioxide in the atmosphere must mean happier plants and more food, right? There are whole websites dedicated to promoting this myth. But that's just what it is, a myth. It's true that some early research from the 1980s did initially suggest that crop yields could increase if carbon dioxide levels doubled in the atmosphere. They were right that all else being equal and with sufficient water and other nutrients, increases in carbon dioxide would make most plants grow a little faster. But unfortunately, as with so many things related to climate change, the answer is not so rosy. In a warmer environment with more carbon dioxide, plants do mature faster, but they build up less plant matter. So it takes more plants to get the same yield. A large enough increase in temperature or a change in drought risk can even eliminate those few benefits. An experiment studying the relative effects of carbon dioxide on valuable crops as compared to common weeds show that in a head-to-head match, the weeds win hands down. Warmer conditions with higher carbon dioxide levels cause weeds to grow faster, up to 3 times faster than crops. Not only that, but many weeds and pests are also limited by cold. But as temperatures warm, these species are on the move too. Kudzu, it's that big leafy green vine you see all across the southeast growing over everything that isn't moving. It was native to Japan. But in the early part of the last century, farmers were urged to plant it to help curb soil erosion. Today, it swiftly and completely envelops houses, telephone lines, even trees. It's estimated that governments and utility companies spend about $500 million a year just ripping it off essential infrastructure. But nothing can keep it back. It used to be known as the vine that ate the South. But now it's seen all the way up through Illinois and even over the border into Canada. Why? Because winters now aren't cold enough to keep it at bay. So although plants might seem to benefit from climate change and more carbon dioxide, there are some serious qualifications to that conclusion. Weeds and invasives benefit more than most crops, and high temperatures and changing rainfall and drought patterns are already wreaking havoc on food supplies around the world. Since 1980, it's estimated, climate change has already cost us $5 billion a year on average in wheat and maize losses, much of that occurring in poor countries, where any change in food availability bites deep. We are currently conducting an unprecedented experiment with our planet, and it's the only one we have. Plants, animals, and entire ecosystems are made up of a multitude of intricate connections. We may be altering those connections and affecting the species themselves in ways that we don't yet fully grasp. But we do know one thing for sure. The faster climate changes, the greater the risk for all of us. Thank you for watching Global Weirding. Be sure to check out globalweirdingseries.com every other Wednesday for a new episode. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube page, like us on Facebook, and follow me on Twitter. Have a question about climate change? We want to hear it. We'll have a live Q&A on our Facebook page every other Thursday at 7 p.m. Central. See you next time.